Thy name may never be in light's own marquee. The world may not applaud when I sing. But if I can be a light to a friend in the night, that's all that I desire to be. So remind me, Lord, would you call me? Sometimes I may be weary, but if one soul is saved, this worthy all. When I see those teardrops falling, it reminds me of my calling, and may I never run from the call. When I was just a child, I knew all the while He wanted me to sing, Lord, just for you. Now I can't count the miles, sometimes I get so tired, but after all you've done, it's the least that I can do. So remind me, Lord, you call me. Sometimes I may be weary, but if one soul is saved, it's worth it all. When I see those teardrops falling, it reminds me of my calling, and may I never run from the call. There's a world out there dying, full of lonely people crying. Chose me to tell them about you, about you. So remind me, Lord, to call me. Sometimes I may be weary, but if one soul is saved, it's worth it all. When I see those teardrops falling, they remind me of my calling, and may I never run from the call. Lord, I don't want to run from your call.
Amen.
Amen.
I put my heart into this. I believe that God has called us all. That song spoke to me individually. I hope it spoke to you, because God has called us all to be a witness for Him. He really has. Let's pray. Loving Father in heaven, we again, vessels, those made of the dust of the earth, come before you asking for the wisdom that you have so freely promised in the book of James. And Father, as we look at the blue stone, I pray that you would give us that wisdom and understanding in Jesus' precious name. Amen. I'd like to begin by looking at the ancient temple of the Israelites, that portable temple that went with them in the wilderness. And I want to begin with the question, what did it all mean? You have a group of people who have been slaves. They're now at Mount Sinai. They've made that journey, and we're going to look at that journey again and see what it means. But ultimately, God had a sanctuary created to teach them the plan of salvation in pictures and in action. So keep this in mind. This is not a system that was created so that the children of Israel could work their way to heaven. This is all designed to teach the plan of salvation. The plan of salvation has always been the same. If I understand my Bible, it says the Lamb slain from the
foundation
of the world. That includes the Old Testament, ladies and gentlemen. There's only one way to be saved, and that is through the precious blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's called righteousness by faith. And the messages that I've been presenting from the book of Revelation, the three angels' message, in verity is righteousness by faith. That was the call of the great Protestant Reformation, that we're saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ, and that we do not need a man-made mediator between us and God. We have the man Christ Jesus, and we need to rejoice over that today. So you notice that there's a courtyard, and then there is a structure, and in that courtyard are basically two pieces of furniture. There's the bronze altar where the sacrifice is made, and there's a thing called the laver, which the priest would wash themselves before they went into the sanctuary. And out of all the questions that mankind could ask, one would be, God, I want to know you. I want to know about you. In fact, how many of you want to know more about God? You do, don't you? Amen. The more you learn about Him, the more you learn about yourself. The more you know that you need Him. Yes. Well, I love this text in Psalm 77:13. Your way, O God, is in the sanctuary. Who is so great a God as our God? So the Bible is crystal clear. If you want to understand God, we can use the same method that God used to teach the children of Israel about Himself. And it's found in the sanctuary. Now, as we fast forward in time from that verse that we just read to the book of Revelation, we notice that the Bible says in Revelation 11:19, then the temple of God was opened where? In heaven. While the majority of evangelical Protestants are looking for an earthly temple made in Jerusalem, the true believers of the Bible and those that understand their deep relationship with Christ are always going to keep their eyes on where Jesus is at. And the Bible says that the temple of God was opened in what?
Heaven.
And the ark of His covenant, sorry about the blurred words, was seen in His temple. Why do we need a man-made temple on the earth when we have His temple, where He is at? And the Ark of the Covenant, He said, was seen in His temple. And there was lightning and noises and thundering and earthquake and great hail. Hebrews chapter 9 and verse 11, the Apostle Paul assures us that we have a representative in the heavenly temple. Who is that representative? But Christ came as high priest of good things to come with the greater and more perfect tabernacle. What's the greater and more perfect tabernacle? The one that Jesus is the high priest of. Not made with hands, that is not of this creation. For Christ has not entered into the holy places made with hands, which are copies of the true, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us. Case closed. Jesus is our mediator. Christ is our great high priest. Christ is in the heavenly temple, ladies and gentlemen. Why do we need to reconstruct another temple and start up animal sacrifices? Ladies and gentlemen, what does that do to Jesus? Now there's a little term, and we're getting a little deeper in our studies, especially in the Revelation class. And everyone's welcome that would like to come on Tuesday night. Need to let Lynn know if you haven't been in the class and you're planning on coming so that they'll have enough materials. But we're going deeper. We're going to understand some of the terms that are used in the seminary, or should we call it the cemetery? Maybe we should. The seminary.
They haven't heard you yet.
You see, if it's just all head knowledge, and we joke, we ministers joke, you know, go seminary, it just kind of rhymes, you know. It can become a dead place. It really can. If all it is a transmission of intellectual knowledge into your head so that you can wow church members. Yeah. That's not the purpose. It's to bring us closer to Christ by understanding more fully the original languages and the intent and so forth. Yeah. Anyway, typology in the Bible. A type is a shadow cast on the pages of the Old Testament history by a truth whose full embodiment or antitype is found in the New Testament revelation. And I think Baker's Dictionary of Theology, page 533, gives a good explanation of what typology is. Simple. Old Testament, they take a lamb. The sinner would place his hands on the head, confess his sins. The throat is cut, the blood is taken, sprinkled on the altar. Many times it's brought into the first department and sprinkled on the veil as a memory, as a record. Now, with that in mind, what is the antitypical fulfillment of that type? Jesus coming as the Lamb of God, the literal Christ dying on the literal cross, spilling his literal blood, was a fulfillment of those rituals of the past. Now you might say, well, were they saved by killing animals? No. They were saved by faith, believing that the Messiah, the Lamb, was coming, that the type would have an antitypical fulfillment in Jesus. So as we look at the experience of the children of Israel, especially those of you that have studied the sanctuary for years, you're going to see some things that maybe you've never seen before. Maybe you have. Let's continue. Let's look at the sanctuary. This is just kind of a primer on the sanctuary. You have the courtyard, the altar of burnt offerings. You have the laver. You have the structure of the tabernacle. You have two apartments, the holy place and the most holy. You have the table of showbread in the first apartment. You have the seven branch candlesticks. And you have the altar of burnt incense. The courtyard spiritually represents justification. This represents the cross of Calvary. This represents baptism, ladies and gentlemen. As you're moving, and as a Christian, when you are born again, you experience a sanctifying life each day, being born again. And it's interesting to note that you come and you eat of the bread, you drink of the wine, spiritually of the Word of God. You have a prayer life with Christ. Your prayers are lifted up. And if these two things are active in your life, and I had to learn this, Pastor Scotty, as a young pastor in one of my first districts that I ever pastored. The church was just, forgive me, I'm an old man now, but it was filled with a bunch of old people. In fact, it was 23. Two old men and the rest were old ladies. And one old man and one old lady ran the church until we had a come to Jesus moment in my office. Or he came over the desk at me and told me that I had to leave. He didn't understand that I grew up scrapping. No, we didn't get into a fist fight. Don't go there. But in my 20s, I just stood up. I looked him in the eye. I said, hey, buddy, you're going, not me. He left and my church grew. Exploded. Then he said, Steve, why did you bring that up? I don't know why I brought it up, so let's just keep going. It's one of those moments in time that it just happens. It'll come to me in a moment. So you have the first apartment. You have the second apartment. And sanctification takes place here every day. Oh, I know why I brought it up. Because of the witnessing. I was standing up there asking, I was preaching my little heart out. We need to reach this community. We need to grow. We need to lead people to Jesus. And I was talking to a bunch of religious people. They were good people, but they were not spiritual people. There's a vast difference between being a good church-going moral person and an on-fire, born-again person. An on-fire, born-again person naturally is going to shine, ladies and gentlemen. If you're spending time in the Word of God and you have an active prayer life, and it's not about, oh, woe me, how sinful I am, but it's about, Lord, save my nephew, save my niece, save my son, save my daughter, that old cranky neighbor next door, oh, Lord, I don't like him, but help me to love him and lead him to you. I'm telling you, people that are on fire for God, ladies and gentlemen, they care about the things God cares about. Amen. Lost people. How many times has somebody pulled up next to you And you look at them and you say, boy, music's blaring, the whole car's just shaking. You know what I'm saying? That boom, 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 boom. My son did that to my car. I guess he thought it was his car. And every once in a while, I'd pull up to a red light and I'd flip that boombox switch. Boom, boom, boom. People look over and be like, old man's trying to get in touch with his youth. But you look at them and go, oh, lost kid. Next time, look over at them and say, they need Jesus. Lord, touch that person's heart. Think about this, fellow church members, fellow believers in Christ. How many people do you come across every day that no one in the world cares about, nor is anyone lifting them up in prayer? Think about that. Start looking at people differently. Don't look at them as, oh, I've got all this knowledge and I know all these things and I eat a certain way and I drink a certain way and I dress a certain way and I've got all my little ducks in a row at center over there. No. Oh, Lord, there I am without you and I want them to be with you. Life becomes exciting. It's a journey every day to share Christ with other people. Okay. And then you move in, you got justification out here, you got sanctification here. By the way, this is a daily work right here. Sanctification is what is called imparted righteousness. It's a daily experience. This is imputed righteousness. Christ covers you. God looks at you as though you've never sinned before. Have you ever sinned before? Yeah. Of course you have. I have. Some of us have sinned on the way here today. Hopefully we haven't sinned since we've been here. But Christ covers us. He covers that unrighteousness with His righteousness because we ask Him to do it. And folks, listen to me. You got to believe it. It's the devil that tries to get you to believe that your performance, oh man, I'm shining today. Man, I'm hitting on all cylinders, Pastor. Everything's going good. So I'm holy. I feel holy today. Doesn't matter how you feel. Do you believe? Do you believe? Do you believe? And never forget, for those of you that are on the edge or whatever, wherever you're at, Jesus kept bad company. And here's something I've learned as a minister. You've got to be who you are. You don't come here and be one person, then out there be another person. Just be who you are. Seriously. Be who you are. Don't worry about who's around you. Be who you are. Just be sanctified in Christ. We're not all puppets. We're all supposed to all look the same, act the same, think the same, say the same words. That stuff doesn't work for me. We're to be who we are in Christ. And then there's the most holy place where the Ark of the Covenant is at, two tables of stone. Okay, so we got this little idea. The fulfillment of the sanctuary was all about Christ. Now, notice this very quickly. Jesus in the sanctuary. Sacrifice takes place outside of Jerusalem, outside of the temple, in the courtyard. Jesus' intercession. The Bible says that He is our intercessor. He's our advocate. And then in the judgment scene, which we'll understand more fully as we get into deeper into Revelation. Now, that little bit of background is going to help us understand this sermon. Opening night of the meetings, we started with Daniel chapter 2. We looked at the rise and fall of empires, Babylon, Medo, Persia, Greece, Rome, 10 divisions, 10 toes. And then we saw a rock cut out without hands. And I told you on opening night, the focus for me is the rock. It's great to know the dates of the rise and fall of empires and to know all these different things about them. But the most important thing is to know the rock. And I want you to notice the symbol that is used, a rock. In Daniel chapter 2 and verse 45, inasmuch as you saw that the stone was cut out of the mountain without hands, and that it broke in pieces the iron, the bronze, the clay, the silver, and the gold, the great God has made known to the king what will come to pass after this. The dream is certain and its interpretation is what?
Sure.
Can you take this one to the bank?
Yes.
You can believe on it. So what is this rock? Paul's going to explain it to us in 1 Corinthians chapter 10. This is mind-blowing. We read it all the time, but we miss the message. Paul says in verse 1, "Moreover, brethren, I do not want you to be unaware that all your fathers were under the cloud, all passed through the sea. All were baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea." Verse 3, "All ate the same," what kind of food, ladies and gentlemen? Spiritual food is what it says. "And they all drank the same spiritual drink." Catch that. Hold on to that. "For they drank of that spiritual rock." Catch that. "That followed them," and that rock was who?
Christ.
Did you know that? That the rock followed the children of Israel through the wilderness, and they drank from that rock. And that rock was Christ. Christ is his heavenly name. Jesus is his earthly name. And when you have the God-man, you have Jesus Christ. Now, all these things happened to them as examples in the them of the children of Israel, and they were written for our admonition, on whom the ends of the ages, or some translations say the end of the world, has come. So our antennas ought to go up, ladies and gentlemen, when we read this verse, because it says, hey, pay attention. Paul's saying, listen, you guys down here at the end of time, in the last few seconds of Earth's history, there's a lesson for you to learn, Paul is saying, from 1 Corinthians 10. There's something very, very important there. Now, let's notice some key observations. One, Israel was baptized into the sea. Did you catch that? What sea did they go through? The Red Sea, right? All right. Israel was baptized into the cloud also. Did you catch that? Did you know that there was a cloud that followed them every day? And there's a pillar of fire by night? None of this stuff was wasted, ladies and gentlemen. It all had meaning. Israel drank of a supernatural rock. The rock that followed them, the rock is identified as Christ or Jesus. We'll stick with Christ. Now, there are three main points that we're going to look at to understand what Paul was saying in 1 Corinthians chapter 10. We're going to take a journey. The rock is the source of moral certainty. And you say, Steve, what does moral certainty mean? It means this. The rock, who is Christ, is the source of the Ten Commandments.
Yes.
And this business of preachers running around saying that the law of God has been nailed to the cross, that the Ten Commandments have been nailed to the cross, ladies and gentlemen, they are responsible for a lot of the damage that is done out here in society today. If you've got the church saying that the Ten Commandments have been nailed to the cross, then where's adultery? Where's lying? Where's stealing? Where's murder? How can a church cry out, we need to keep the law of God, and at the same time say it's been nailed to the cross? You say, you're getting worked up, Steve. I do get worked up about this. I do. I'm a human being, just like you are. Do any of you ever get worked up over anything?
Yes.
Of course you do. Jesse, do you ever get worked up? All the time. Jared, I don't know if you get worked up. You seem to be pretty steady. I think Jesse's got more of a personality like mine. You may be preaching one day. We get this thing straight. Uh-oh, I'm in trouble now. Did you know that every one of your preachers in here? Every one of you women in here are preachers. Did you know that? This is the priesthood of all believers. Your life preaches a sermon every day, ladies and gentlemen. Does it not?
Yes.
All right? So let's be clear. The rock is the source of living water. Not just drinking water, but living water. And the rock is the source of eternal salvation. Now let's look at each one of these. The rock is the source of the Ten Commandments, our moral certainty. So we pick up the story with Moses. He's in the wilderness, or he's about to go into the wilderness. And in Exodus chapter 13, verse 21, "And the Lord went before them by day in a pillar of cloud, to lead the way, and by night in a pillar of fire to give them light, so as to go by day and night." He did not take away the pillar of cloud by day or the pillar of fire by night from before the people. Now the natural question would be is, where is he leading them? Where are they going? And I'd like to submit to you that the very journey that they take, from the moment that they make a sacrifice in Egypt and they begin their journey towards Mount Sinai, there's two things that are going to be abundantly clear. The journey itself is a walk through the sanctuary that's going to be built. That's right. You will see that clearly. Also, the sanctuary is built off creation week too. If you've studied Genesis carefully, you know that. And notice where God's going to take them. He's taking them to His house on Mount Sinai. Exodus 15:13, you in your mercy have led forth the people whom you have redeemed. You have guided them in your strength to your what? I'm hard of hearing. Okay. God's bringing them out of Egypt to His house. In verse 17, you will bring them in and plant them in the mountain of your inheritance, in the place, O Lord, which you have made for your own dwelling, the sanctuary, O Lord, which your hands have established. Did you catch that? God is waiting for them. Christ is bringing them. He's waiting for them. And He's on the mountain and He says, this is my house. In fact, Moses is going to get the plans to build the earthly sanctuary up there. And it's not like God saying, okay, now let's get this table laid out here and let's get all these blueprints. If you've ever built a house and you haven't been schooled in blueprints, go get schooled in blueprints before you try to build a house. Because you need to know that you know that you know that you know. Because guess what? There's an inspector coming. And he'll know if you don't know. And he'll fail you. You get failed enough times, you start paying. Voice of experience here. I know that I know that I paid money out. Because I failed. Now, He's bringing them to the sanctuary. So here's just the graphic. There's the earthly temple that Moses is going to go up there on the mountain and he's going to get instructions. Now, I'm going to make a statement that I'm going to come back and prove it biblically that Mount Sinai is the prototype sanctuary. That's where he got the idea. That's where he got the plans to build the earthly sanctuary, ladies and gentlemen. In Hebrews chapter 8 and verse 5, who served the copy and the shadow of the heavenly things. The earthly sanctuary is nothing more than a copy and a shadow. And once it ran its course, there was no need for a copy of a shadow anymore. That's why I, with great confidence, know that an earthly temple is unnecessary. As Moses was divinely instructed when he was about to make the tabernacle, for he said, see that you make all things according to the pattern shown you where?
On the mountain.
On the what?
On the mountain.
So he saw the pattern. Now, let's go back and look at the journey of the children of Israel. The bronze altar began. The experience of the bronze altar began in Egypt with a thing called Passover. How many of you have heard of Passover? You remember what the Bible says? It said this. Take the sacrifice, kill it, mingle it with herbs. Cook it, roast it. Take your, be fully clothed, have your staff in your hand, and take the blood. But his and you put it over your doorpost so that when the plague falls, that when the death angel flies over your house, your firstborn will not be touched if there's blood on the doorpost. Dad, you better make sure there's door and blood post at your house, spiritually. Dads, we need to stand up and be the real men that our wives want us to be. That blood spread on that doorpost. Angel came over, the death angel saw the blood, passed over. Israel was not delivered from the plague. They were delivered from the results of the plague if they complied with the blood. It's always been the same. It's the blood, ladies and gentlemen.
Yes.
You're not going to be secretly raptured out of here. We're going to go through the plagues. God will protect us in the plagues. Example after example after example in the Bible. The blood has to be applied to the heart of the individual. Has the blood been applied to your heart? Is Jesus all in all to you? Is he the most important to you? So, we start at the bronze altar, we start in Egypt with the Passover. We're moving forward. We come to the laver next. That's the Red Sea, ladies and gentlemen. That's the Red Sea. The natural step of a Christian, a person that has been to the cross and been broken, and the blood's been applied to their heart, the natural step they take is baptism next. What the Bible teaches. Baptism. Death to self. Burial. Resurrection to the newness of life. I've had people say to me, "Oh, Steve, I need to be baptized, but I don't want to be a part of a church. I just want to kind of do my own thing." You're asking a minister to be very unbiblical. You become part of the body of Christ, ladies and gentlemen. There's a reason for baptism. It's got to be just like you say. I want to marry you. But I'm really not going to be around. I probably won't support you. I'll come around every once in a while. How long would that last? Ladies, how many of you would just like to have a husband like that? He just comes around every once in a while. The seed forms. Paul says that they were baptized where? In the sea. So they're making their way to Mount Sinai. They're making their way to the most holy place, ladies and gentlemen. In their very journey, God is teaching them the plan of salvation. The blood, the Passover. You go through the waters. You come out on the other side. The sanctuary parallels the mountains. The two apartments can be found there, ladies and gentlemen. Notice, the furniture of the holy place had its parallels on the mountain. Moses saw the burning bush in Exodus 3, 1 and 2. That was early on in his experience. On that mountain, he saw the burning bush. On Mount Sinai, the Bible says in Exodus 25, 33 that the lampstand was patterned after an almond tree. Both the burning bush and the lampstand burned with fire representing God's presence. And this is so important. It wasn't in the earthly sanctuary that somebody just walked along and lit a candle with a match or a Bic lighter. Not at all. Holy fire. By the way, you're going to understand hellfire. Understand the fire that's in the sanctuary. It's eternal fire. It's God's presence. And that's what consumes the wicked. These preachers running around saying hell's in the center of the earth, burning, burning, and burning. They don't really realize what they're doing to themselves. It's a fable and a fairy tale. It's Greek mythology. And yet they're preaching it as God's holy word. And they're using words in the Bible that don't even mean Gehenna, the place of burning. You see, anywhere there's a word hell, they just use it to try to scare people with it. The only way for people to be convinced is not a fire escape religion. No. It's the broken heart through the moving of the Spirit of God upon the heart that melts the heart. Fear does motivate people, but it doesn't last long. Love is a different story.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes. A different story. I had a lot of people throughout my life telling me I was headed to the place of destruction. And I heard it, and I went in one ear and out the other. In fact, one of them was getting on to me about some spiritual things, and I wasn't a Christian, and I looked at him and basically said, you know, if you are a representative of Christianity, I don't want to have any part of it. Both the burning bush and the lampstand burned with fire, representing God's presence. In Exodus 24, verse 11, the Bible says the 70 elders of Israel, together with Moses and Aaron, ate and drank on the mountain. In Exodus 25, 29, the Bible says that the table of showbread had containers for drink offerings and bread, representing God's presence. The holy place contained an altar. In Exodus 24, 4, Moses built an altar at the foot of the mountain. So all that had to do with the holy place. And that's why I'm giving you that manuscript, so you can go home and look at it and go over it. The Ark of the Covenant had its parallels on the mountain. Now, this is where it gets heavy. Then Moses went up, also Aaron, Nadab, Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel. And they saw the God of Israel, and there was under his feet, as it were, a paved work of what kind of stone?
Sapphire.
That's a blue stone. And we know from an initial meeting of God and Moses, God turned his backside to him. Remember? His head was glowing and he came down and the people said, man, you got to cover your head up. I want to glow like that, don't you? I mean, going into the presence of God every day and being changed and transformed and filled with the Spirit every day. You go forth glowing for Christ. And there was under his feet, as it were, a paved work of sapphire stone. And it was like the very heavens in its what? Clarity. So they look up and they see the glory and they see this blue sapphire stone that God's standing on. Don't lose that. But on the nobles of the children of Israel, he did not lay his hands. So they saw God, they ate and they drank. Then the Lord said to Moses, come up to me on the mountain and be there, and I will give you tablets. Now notice this text very carefully. I will give you tablets of stone and the law and commandments which I have written that you may what?
Teach
them. Where did the Ten Commandments come from?
From God.
The Ten Commandments are unique to us here on planet Earth. Do you realize that? Would it make any sense for the seventh commandment for the angels in heaven in the sense of physical? Do not commit adultery. Maybe in the spiritual sense, you don't run after Lucifer, but it's given for a planet that can procreate, ladies and gentlemen. We are a unique creation in God's creation. We have been created to procreate.
Yes.
And with procreation, God has given us a wall to protect us.
Yes.
And you, the dangers. Man were to fall. Another man looks at another man's wife, takes her. It breaks down the family unit. You can't hardly turn the TV on anymore and look at regular TV or cable TV or whatever kind of TV that there's not immorality going on, and it has become so commonplace that the majority of people, I'm going to have to use code language because this is going on YouTube. That a relationship between a man and a woman outside of wedlock is just a common thing. Now people just go, oh, yeah. But yet the same people will scream and howl about a relationship between the other kind of relationship. Both in the eyes of God are sin.
Yes.
It may make you feel pious and holy to ramble on about all that stuff that's going on out there. You've got to make sure your own heart's clean and clear. since sin. And when the Bible says that no one immoral will enter into the kingdom of heaven, that means a man committing adultery or fornication or a woman, unless changed by the blood of Jesus, will not enter the kingdom of heaven. Keep that in mind. Be careful about the music you listen to. Oh, but it's country music, Steve. Yeah, we're out fornicating on Saturday night, but we're in the church on Sunday morning. The two don't go together. We are being conditioned, ladies and gentlemen. We're being conditioned to look at God's Word as watered down and filtered through popular culture today. The Word of God is the Word of God, and it has never changed.
Amen.
And if we are born again by Christ, we will be a loving, kind Christian. Religious people tend to be mean Christians. They're quick to judge, quick to condemn, quick to want to slap somebody else down because I'm not doing that. We need to be careful. That's why I'm saying we need to be broken every day at the foot of Calvary. Broken. Every day. The literal Hebrew should be translated tables of the stone or the tables of the stone. What does this mean? The literal Hebrew indicates that the stone tablets came from the stone. The only stone in the context is the blue stone. And that is the stone that God is standing on. Ladies and gentlemen, Moses didn't go up into heaven with a chisel and a hammer and chisel out two pieces of sandstone and hand up to God and he'd Do you understand what the Bible is saying? That the law of God has come forth from the very throne of God. And I'm going to prove that to you in just a moment. I'm going to show you directly from Ezekiel that the Bible says that the throne of God was the blue sapphire. And the law issued, it came forth from that throne. And we're going to see in a few moments that the throne of God is eternal and never changes. So when I hear preachers running around saying, oh, the law of God's been nailed to the cross, it's been done away with. Oh, we'll bring 9 back, or we'll leave that 4th commandment. Ladies and gentlemen, it tells me that they don't know what they're talking about. And you say, Steve, you're being arrogant. No, at some point in time, I just got to speak my mind, folks. I hear these guys bellowing on the radio saying this and that and the other. And I'm saying, it's because they don't understand the Old Testament. They don't understand the sanctuary. They have so eclipsed themselves into a little circle of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John that they can't understand what they're even reading to the people. Sincere, honest, good-hearted? Yes. But I'll tell you what, ladies and gentlemen, do not ever trust your soul to a preacher.
Amen.
Not to this preacher, not to that preacher, not to any preacher. And you hear them on the radio and you say, oh, but they're quoting Bible verses. They could be misquoting the Bible verses. How do you know if they're using the Bible verses right? That's why, ladies and gentlemen, we need to know how to study the Bible and spend time with the Bible every day. Jesus has already told us a time is coming on this planet where everything that can be shaken will be shaken. And those that are of the deepest experience with Christ, if it wasn't for His special protection, ladies and gentlemen, they would be shaken away. The signs and wonders and delusions and demonic activity that's coming upon this planet, we have not seen anything yet. I appeal to you to spend time with Christ. I appeal to you to make the Word of God your best friend. So He declared to you His covenant, which He commanded you to perform. That is the 10 commandments. And He wrote them on 2 tables of stone. Just some supporting text showing that God wrote them on the 2 tables of stone. Nothing was in the ark except the 2 tablets which Moses put there at Horeb when the Lord made a covenant with the children of Israel when they had come out of Egypt. Key observation, God was enthroned over the tablets of stone, just like He was over the blue stone. on Mount Sinai. The Bible identifies the Ark of the Covenant as the place where the stone tablets were placed. It follows then that the blue stone corresponds in some way to the Ark of the Covenant. Notice the Ark of the Covenant, my friends. Right here is the Shekinah glory, the two cherubims, the mercy seat, inside the two tables of stone, the Shekinah glory, the presence of God. The two tables of stone are here. God is above it. The mercy seat represents Christ. It's between God, Christ, and a broken law. There is the glory. This is an earthly representation, ladies and gentlemen, of the very mobile throne of the God of heaven. The Bible says the eyes of God are everywhere. And when it seems the darkest on this planet, God's still in control. Quit putting your faith in politicians. I mean, I'm not saying not to vote, but I'll tell you what, if your hopes and your future is resting on human flesh, you will be disappointed. You will be disappointed. The Bible says, do not trust in the arm of flesh. It cannot save you. Only Jesus can.
Yes.
Amen.
There may be some sitting here today that are just simply good, moral, church-going people, and you come here because it makes you feel good, and you know it's the right thing to do. But if you're born again, you come here to fellowship with fellow believers. There's a lot of people that have a very shallow relationship. And there's ways to check yourself. Do I spend quality time in Christ every day? Not as a duty just to do like my Sabbath school lesson, but my heart burns to spend time with Him. And because I've spent time with Him, I long to see lost people saved. Is that where your heart's at? I can tell you right now, if I wouldn't spend time with Christ every day, I'd lose interest in what I'm doing right now. The things of the world would be like a magnet pulling me away. And at best, I'd have one foot in the church and one foot in the world. I'd lose my fervor. I'd lose my dedication. I'd lose the very drive that's in me to present these messages. It's a relationship with Christ that fuels what we do, ladies and gentlemen. It is. So what is the blue stone? Ezekiel 1:4. Notice what the prophet says. Then I looked and behold, the whirlwind was coming out of the north, a great cloud of raging fire engulfing itself, and brightness was all about it. And radiating out of the mist like the color of amber, and out of the mist of the fire, the appearance of the wheels. Notice the wheels. God likes wheels, man. He does. I mean, be like cars, motorcycles. I mean, be like to go fast. She raised her hand. You drive fast.
Golf cart.
Out of the mouth of babes. I like to go safely fast. She goes, she looks at me like that. The appearance of the wheels and their workings were like a color mirror, and all four had the same likeness. The appearance of their workings was, as it were, a wheel in the middle of a wheel. It looked like confusion to Ezekiel. All this stuff moving around. You know what it was saying? It was saying, I am in control. All of this stuff that looks like confusion is perfectly in harmony, moving, and my attention is on this planet. That's good news. The more you read the Bible, the more confident you know that God is in control of this whole thing. And this is a mess down here. I try to stay out of both ditches, but I'm going to say this. The racial problems that we face on this planet, and if you think it's just white and black, I've got news for you. I've traveled around this world. Hispanic people have problems with other people. Asian people have problems with other people. Ladies and gentlemen, it is a sin problem. I'm not saying it's right. Even the disciples were racist until they were fully converted to Jesus Christ. They hated the Gentiles and they called them dogs. You can make 1,000 laws. You can put all kinds of penalties, but you can't change the heart of a human being. Fallen human beings are racist by their nature. The only hope is Christ.
Amen.
Christ. So if you find yourself on a bandwagon that you think you can vote this and force this and make this, you can't. You want the heart. You want to know that this white preacher loves you because he loves you, whatever color you are, because he's in love with Jesus.
Yes. Amen.
Is this making sense?
Amen.
I mean, if I want to have a pity party for me, I can say those wretched Englishmen. I'm a Scotsman. What they did to my ancestors. And by the way, those Romans, they come in, they called my people pigs. You know what that means? They were painted up in pictures. The Scottish would paint their faces before they were called Scottish. I mean, if you study the history of the world, the worst offenders in slavery known to mankind was the Arabs. Islam. But if all you do is sit and watch nonsense on TV, you don't read, you don't study, you don't dig, you won't know. And then whatever politician stands up there and offers you a trinket to vote for him, you will say, no way. My allegiance is to Jesus and Jesus alone. I'm serious.
Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, I get it. There are Democrats, there are Republicans, there are independents, and there is the no man's zone and all of that stuff. And I'm not saying not to be a good citizen. I'm just simply saying don't put your 100% hope in this. Has it ever changed? Sin remains. Christ, Christ alone. When they went towards any one of the four directions. They did not turn aside when they went. I watched till thrones were put in place and the Ancient of Days was seated. His garment was as white as snow and the hair of his head was like pure wool. His throne was a fiery flame, its wheels a burning fire. That's Daniel 7. He's saying the same thing Ezekiel said. Same thing. Same thing. God has a mobile throne. And notice this picture of, of an ancient Judean coin showing God's winged throne with wheels. Check this out. Look at that. That's how the Judeans pictured God. So ladies, if you wonder why men like wheels, it's biblical. Fire was coming off the wheels. Now, I don't know if you can make a case, gentlemen, for a new C8 Corvette off of this. I wouldn't try. But we'd be stretching it, right, Pastor? And refined gold by weight for the altar of the incense is just another supporting text. For the construction of the chariot, that is the gold cherubim, that spread their wings and overshadowed the ark of the covenant of the Lord. Be quiet. Things talking to me. I think they're recording us every which way. Just recorded everything I said. And above the firmament, over the heads, was the likeness of a throne. Notice Ezekiel 1:26. In the appearance like a what?
Sapphire stone.
Sapphire stone. On the likeness of the throne was the likeness and the appearance of a man high above it. Who do you think that was?
God.
God. Also from the appearance of his waist and upward I saw as it were the color of amber, with the appearance of fire all around within it. From the appearance of his waist and downward I saw as it were the appearance of fire, brightness all around. Like the appearance of a rainbow. Now you know why the devil has taken the rainbow and he's tried to destroy the rainbow. There's not a Christian in here that would put a rainbow on their car. But this is the original meaning of the rainbow. Like the appearance of a rainbow in a cloud on a rainy day, so was the appearance of the brightness all around it. This was the appearance of the likeness of the glory of the Lord. So when I saw it, I fell on my face and I heard a voice of one speaking. Now notice these key points. In this verse, Ezekiel identifies the blue stone God is standing on as the throne of God. That means that the sapphire stone God is standing on in Exodus chapter 24 is God's throne. Therefore, the Ten Commandments were taken directly out of God's throne. But to the Son, he says, that's God the Father speaking to the Son, your throne, O God. Jesus is not a makeup God. He's not like the Catholic Church that says God the Father is the origin. He's the only person of the Godhead that is the origin, the original. Christ is lesser. And the Holy Spirit is nothing more than communion between God the Father and God the Son, their love for each other. I just refreshed my memory this week from the latest catechism. I read it there. True Protestant understanding of the Godhead and the Trinity is not the same as the Roman Catholic Church. Beware of people that say that the Protestant, the true Protestant Trinity is just like the Catholic. It is not. If you study, you know that. We need to study like we've never studied before, folks. We need to know. But to the Son, this is God. He, God, speaks. Your throne, O God, he calls Jesus God, is forever and ever a scepter of righteousness. This is the scepter of your kingdom. Now, if God's throne is eternal, then God's law, which came from it, must be eternal.
Yes.
Can't be changed. Now let's go to part number two. I've got to move along very quickly here. I know it's still early. It's before midnight for sure. The rock is the source of living water. Now I'm going to move along very quickly here. Moreover, brethren, I do not want you to be unaware that all our fathers were under the cloud, all passed through the sea. All were baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea. All ate the same spiritual drink. All drank the same spiritual drink. For they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was who?
Christ.
Now, we have some problems. We're out in the wilderness. Children of Israel are thirsting. Notice what happens. Now, we know that God went with the children of Israel in a pillar of fire and cloud. We also know that there was a literal rock in the middle of that cloud, and that rock is identified as God's blue sapphire stone. Paul says very clearly that the children of Israel were baptized into the cloud as well as into the Red Sea. And they all drank from that rock that followed them. The evidence from Paul would seem to suggest that the blue stone was also the source of life-giving water in the desert. In Exodus 17:1, then all the congregation of the children of Israel set out on their journey from the wilderness of Sin according to the commandment of the Lord and encamped to Rapha them. But there was no water for the people to drink. So what did they do? Therefore the people contended with Moses and said, give us water that we may drink. And Moses said to them, why do you contend with me? Why do you tempt the Lord? And the people thirsted there for water. And the people complained against Moses and said, why is it that you have brought us up out of Egypt to kill us and our children and our livestock with thirst? So Moses cried out to the Lord, saying, what shall I do with this people? They're almost ready to stone me. And the Lord said to Moses, here's the instructions that God gave to Moses. Go on before the people. Take with you some of the elders of Israel. Also take in your hand your rod which you struck the river, and go. Behold, I will stand. Now notice what God says. Behold, I will stand before you there on the rock in Horeb. Very specific. And you shall strike the rock. And water will come out of it that the people may drink. And Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. Very important instruction. You take the rod. You strike the rock. Water will come out of the rock. I'm going to be on the rock. You know what God's saying? I'm going to be on my throne. Come touch my throne. It's a little bedtime story. We'll have a picture of a little rock out in the middle of the desert with water, people drinking from it. That's not what the Bible's teaching. Everything comes from the throne, ladies and gentlemen. You will see this clearly. So he called the name of the place Massah and Meribah, because of the contention of the children of Israel, and because they tempted the Lord, saying, is the Lord among us or not? Now notice what happens. Lurking in the shadows of the Amalekites, they are a type of Lucifer in the fallen angels. They are not fallen angels. They are not Lucifer. They are a type of. Now the Amalekites came and fought with Israel at Rephidim. And Moses said to Joshua, I love Joshua. Choose us some men. He didn't say namby-pambies, did he? No. He said, you choose some men. Go out and fight with Amalek. Tomorrow I will stand on the top of the hill with the rod of God in my hand. So Joshua did as Moses said to him, and fought with Amalek. And Moses and Aaron and Hur went up to the top of the hill. And so it was when Moses held his hands high that Israel prevailed. And when he let down his hands, Amalek prevailed. But Moses' hands became very heavy, so they took a stone and they put it under him. And he sat on the stone, and Aaron and Hur supported his hands, one on one side, the other on the other side. And his hands were steady until the going down of the sun. So Joshua defeated Amalek and his people with the edge of the sword. Then the Lord said to Moses, write this for a memory, our memorial in the book, and recount it in the hearing of Joshua, that I will utterly blot out the remembrance of Amalek from under heaven. That is a prophecy that Lucifer will be utterly blotted out. Never be again. The Amalekites come to your house every day. You realize that? When you take out the Word of God, where the living water comes from, and you open it up and you begin to drink, the Amalekites, they're wanting to take the Word away from you. They're wanting to fight with you. They're wanting you to be distracted. They want you to be distracted with good things so that you don't spend time with the best thing. And ladies and gentlemen, right here, the Bible is clearly indicating, we're going to see in just a moment, that the water was proceeding from the throne of God. When we connect with God every day, as long as Moses was connected to the throne of God, there's victory. That's what the Bible is teaching. Those that are trying to do it on their own, and their hands are down, and they're not connected to God through a daily personal relationship, they're defeated by the evil one. It happens. And Moses built an altar and called the name, the Lord is my banner. 16, he said, for hands were lifted up to the throne of the Lord. The Lord will be at war against the Amalekites from generation to generation. The literal Hebrew reads, a hand was upon the throne of the Lord. This would indicate that Moses struck the blue stone as the source of life, giving water to save the people's lives. Now I want you to think about this, because we're going to cover this in just a moment. He struck the rock. Is it coming clear? He struck the rock, and the life-giving force comes out of the rock. We'll see this on the cross of Calvary, ladies and gentlemen. Here's just a couple of texts what God did for Israel. He spread a cloud in Psalms 105, 39-41. He spread a cloud for covering and fire to give light in the night. The people asked, and he brought quail and satisfied them with the bread of heaven. He opened the rock, and water gushed out, and it ran in dry places like a river. The second time Moses hit the rock, he was standing at the door of the tabernacle. We know from Exodus 33, 9 and 10, and Numbers 12, 5, and Deuteronomy 31, 15, that the cloud would rest at the door of the sanctuary where Moses would meet God. Remember, the cloud contained the rock. In these verses, God commanded Moses to speak to the rock. Now notice what happens. He's only to speak to the rock. But instead, he struck it again. And on account of this disobedience, God refused to let him enter into the promised land. You say, boy, that God was really hard on Moses. Moses gave the wrong lesson. Notice Revelation 22:11. We've read it 1,000 times. And he showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding from the throne of God and of the Lamb. Your power, your success, your victory comes from the throne, ladies and gentlemen. We must be connected to the throne. Every day, when we're connected to the throne, the full armor of God is put on us. And we can stand. We can stand. In Ezekiel 47, 1 through 8, we don't have time to read this. I'd like to invite you to go home and read this. But in Ezekiel 47, 1 through 8, everything in the Dead Sea that the water touched comes to life. Notice that the river has its source in the sanctuary. Maybe some of you have heard this song by Stephen Curtis Chapman. The river's deep, the river's wide, the river is alive. In this vision, in Ezekiel 47, the water comes out of the temple, out of the sanctuary, and it's ankle deep, then it's knee deep, then it's waist deep, and the further it goes, life begins to take place. Trees begin to grow. Flowers are there. Birds are there. Fish are in the water. It goes further and further till it reaches the lowest part of planet Earth, the Dead Sea, and it brings life. God said, no matter how dead you are, no matter how far you've gone from God, my water can reach you. I can save you. I'm banking on those promises. Are you? Or are you not banking on those promises, believing that God said, I will save you. I will save you. Don't look to yourself. Look to Him.
Yes.
Look to Him. We're going to close here in just a minute. But remember, second time, Moses was to speak, but he struck. The first time he struck the rock was to indicate to Israel that the Messiah would come and he would go to the cross and he would be struck. By Moses striking the rock, when God said speak to it, it was giving the idea that there would be a second death or a re-crucifixion of the Messiah. That's heavy. God said, you gave him the wrong message. You basically erased the first message. The second time, ladies and gentlemen, you know where the fulfillment of the second time speaking to the rock was supposed to was? Acts 2. They prayed. And the Holy Spirit was poured out with fullness. 50 days after the cross. God was teaching Israel what was coming. And the very fact that Moses misconstrued the sermon to the children of Israel, God said, I can't let you go in the promised land. You've given them the wrong message. I can't afford to give you the wrong message because I want to go into the kingdom.
Amen.
If some of you are sitting there thinking it's cool to be a preacher and you get paid and this and that and the other, I'm going to tell you what. It's a grave responsibility. Every word I say is weighed not only with you but with God. If I'm a coward and I preach smooth, easy things when the destruction is right on the horizon and I don't warn, the Bible says your blood is on me. I'm going to drag you into this too, Scotty. So sometimes there's some hard sermons preached because the preacher's delivering his soul. But you see, if all you do as church members just wait for the sermon once a week, and you're not preparing your heart all week long by your relationship with Jesus, you'll be bored, you'll be ready to go, you'll be thinking of other things. You'll be saying things like this in your mind, I wish you would just shut up and hurry up and get done. I know, been there. In fact, at my sister's graduation from a Christian school, I was sitting there with my girlfriend, who would have made Jezebel blush. A young man stood up and he said, I'm going into the ministry. I turned to my girlfriend and I said, there's a fool for you right there. And then this older gentleman, he gets up and he starts talking about how wonderful it is that these young people are getting a Christian education. And I turned to her, I remember the words. He's a clown. Little did I know that that young man would lead my brother to Christ. Little did I know that that man that I called a clown would lay his hands upon me to ordain me into the gospel ministry. Who was the fool that day? Me! I was the fool. Listen, ladies and gentlemen, I didn't ask for all of this. If I had it my way, before I was converted, I had a great job making lots of money, fast cars, fast motorcycles. I was living the life. Didn't hurt for money. Didn't hurt for friends. But when I met Jesus Christ and He broke my heart, He had to bring me to the dust. And to break me of those habits. Take those things away. This is not an easy thing to be a minister. Most important thing to be a minister, though, is you got to have your heart right with God.
Amen.
A lot of people are concerned about, do they have this degree or that degree? Better be worried about being a B.A., born again. The literal rock is the source of eternal salvation. This is it. We're going to close here in just a moment. When a Samaritan woman came to draw water, Jesus said to her, you get this, ladies? This is a Samaritan woman. Samaritans were hated by Jews. And if you were a Samaritan woman, you were double hated. Racist. But why did Jesus speak to her? Jesus didn't care about their stupid laws and rules and regulations. Maybe young kids, I'm sorry I said that. Your parents would tell you not to say that. Silly rules and regulations. Their traditions. Jesus ignored all of that because He saw a soul that He wanted to save. Jesus said to her, will you give me a drink? Notice her response. Then the woman of Samaria said to Him, how is it that you, being a Jew, ask a drink from me, a Samaritan woman? For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans. Jesus answered and said to her, if you knew the gift of God and who it is who says to you, give me a drink, you would have asked Him and He would have given you living water. What's He saying? I want to save you. I want to save you. The woman said to Him, sir, you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Where then do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as well as his sons and his livestock? Jesus answered and said to her, whoever drinks of this well will thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him will never thirst. the rock. But the water that I shall give him will become in him a fountain of water springing up into everlasting life. So you see, Jesus is the source of life-giving water. He calls himself the source of life-giving water. Now I want to take you to the seventh month of the Jewish calendar, to the seventh feast of the Jewish feast system. I want to take you to the seventh day of the seventh month of the seventh feast. And this is the day that Jesus says these words. As he begins to speak, ladies and gentlemen, there's an altar there. And on top of that altar are two funnels. Two tubes are going down. They connect together and they go to a little stream. And the little stream finally ends up at the Kidron, from the Kidron to the Dead Sea. On this day, with the priests with their beautiful regalia, one with a beautiful silver container with water, and one with a beautiful silver container with wine. And a great parade takes place, and they walk up to the altar, they pour the water, they pour the wine, they go down the tubes, they mingle together, and finally, they go down to the Dead Sea. And all the people are standing there, and the meaning of this is lost on them. They don't get it. They don't see it. On the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried out, saying, "If anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink." While this ceremony is going on, Jesus cries out, "Are you thirsty? Are you tired of drinking from broken cisterns that hold no water? Are you tired of fixing yourself with band-aids and fig leaves? Are you tired of the guilt?" And ladies and gentlemen, guilt can also manifest itself in great physical pain. On the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried out, saying, "If anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink." In verse 38, "And he who believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. But this he spoke concerning the Spirit, whom those believing in him would receive. For the Holy Spirit was not yet given." It was coming. That was speaking to the rock. Prayer, great outpouring of Pentecost. "For the Holy Spirit was not yet given," because Jesus was not yet what? Glorified. That striking rock. Now let's go to the cross and end. "Therefore, because it was the preparation day, that the body should not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for that Sabbath was a high Sabbath." So when a yearly Sabbath fell on a weekly seventh-day Sabbath, came a high Sabbath. "The Jews asked Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away." I want you to see this. Here's a whole group of people worried about breaking the Sabbath. But they just killed the creator of the Sabbath. Don't make the Sabbath a death sentence on your children or your grandchildren. Don't require spiritual things of unspiritual people. Yes, you got to set boundaries. I know, parents. I understand that. But do it with love and kindness and gentleness. You can turn your children away by being harsh and hardened. This is the rule and this is what God says. Do it with love, kindness, conversion. I have to ask God, how do I speak to my grandson? How do I speak to him? What do I say to him? How can I reach his little mind? How can I reach him where he's at? Because he may not have the time that you've given me
to be with you where I'm at now. He may not have that time. Parents, your children are special gifts from God. They are. Don't make following Christ harsh, hard, rigid. The only way I know to be a good parent is to spend time with Christ. There's no guarantee. Lucifer went bad. Don't forget. He did. The Jews asked Pilate that they might, that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. Then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the second who were crucified. You know, by breaking the legs, you collapse down and it causes you to smother. You drown. Crucifixion is horrid. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. What did they do? But one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and immediately blood and water came out. The rock had been struck. It's opened up. The blood is the salvation, the water is the Holy Spirit. And I can imagine that wound on the side of Jesus open with the blood and the water running down his leg, running down the cross, running down the hill of the skull symbolically, reaching to the lowest depths of humanity. Ladies and gentlemen, today is the day. We make things right with Christ by letting him have his way in our life. I want a little card passed out right now. I have a little card talking about my commitment to Christ. And once the card is passed out and I go through it, I do know about this song. Pastor Scott is going to come up and he's going to sing the Midnight Cry. And as he sings, I pray, just hand them out, guys. It's one stack at a time. It doesn't matter if there's two people. That's it. Just hand out the stacks. There you go. Pass them out. Keep going. There you go. I love it when I see these young guys working for the Lord. Ladies and gentlemen, the blood of Jesus has been spilled for all of us. And we can make a decision for Jesus today. We truly can. I'm going to go through this little card with you. And then while you're contemplating what Jesus would have you do, Pastor Scott is going to come up and sing. Today, I surrender my life to Jesus, accepting him as my Savior and Lord. I eagerly desire to follow him all the way and thank him for leading me into his truth, which is his Bible. Because I desire to be ready when Jesus comes, I wish to be baptized like Jesus soon. In the near future, we're going to have a baptism here. And there may be some here that have never been biblically baptized before. And you hear the call of the Spirit upon your heart to be baptized like Jesus was. Death to self, buried under the water, resurrected to the newness of life. Let the Holy Spirit have his way in your life today. Say yes to him. Maybe there's some here today that would like to say, you know, I need to be rebaptized. When I was a kid, I was baptized and I was sincere, but I drifted a long ways away from what I committed to as a child. Maybe there are some of you here today that have drifted a long ways away and you need to be rebaptized. And Christ is speaking to your heart. Now I'm going to forewarn you, there's a battle going on right now. There's a battle going on inside of you. I've been there. I know. The devil's going to tell you, you've got to clean yourself up, you've got to straighten yourself up before you can be baptized. No, surrender your heart to Christ. Just allow him to have your heart. He'll clean you up. You can't clean yourself up. Can't fix yourself. Bible says a leopard can't change his spots. You can't change your spots. There may be some here today that would like to say, you know, I've been biblically baptized before, but I want to be a part of this community. I want to be a part of this church. I want to be a part of this family. I believe the truth that I've been learning from the Bible, and I want to be a part. I'd like to be a part of this fellowship. I'd like to be a member here. But I've already been biblically baptized. I don't need to be rebaptized. Wonderful thing about this church is we accept your biblical baptism in Christ. And you can become a part of this fellowship, this community of believers, by profession of faith, by simply saying, I want to be a part. So, Pastor, would you please come up and sing for us? And as you sing, folks, I pray that you will contemplate. Let's not focus on the pastor, not focus on Steve. Focus on the decision that Jesus would have you make. And I'm going to tell you about baptism. It doesn't mean you're going to be baptized tomorrow or next week. It means that you've made that commitment. And then we're going to talk and study and understand. It's like a marriage, ladies and gentlemen. You don't meet a person, hopefully, and the next day you're getting married in Las Vegas. It takes time, commitment. Even Philip, when he met the eunuch, had been studying the Word of God. He had been questioning, and the Lord allowed a divine appointment. So I pray that as you contemplate, Pastor, will you sing for us?
Yeah.
and a midnight cry. When Jesus comes again, oh, and then those that remain shall be quickly changed. We'll all be changed at the midnight cry. When Jesus comes again.
Fast approaching. Father, your Son has told us to watch and pray that we might be ready. Lord, I pray that no one leaves this room. No one that has not said yes to you. I understand, Lord, that a person convinced against their will is of the same opinion still. But you can do a work that no human being can do. Father, I pray that victories will be won today. Decisions will be made. Hearts will be yielded to you. And Lord, may we joyfully not only look for and prepare for, but to help others be ready to meet you in the clouds of glory, because it is coming soon. Thank you for this moment in time. We praise you and give honor and glory to you. In Jesus' wonderful and precious name. Amen.